Bienvenidos a este nuevo programa de podcast de libros organizados por el Centro de Estudios Públicos. Mi nombre es Juan Luis Sosa y hoy estaremos conversando con Eric Nelson, historiador de la Universidad de Harvard y autor de The Royalist Revolution, Monarchy and the American Founding. How are you, Professor Nelson?
Very well, thank you. Thank you for having me.
Thank you very much for agreeing to have this conversation. We hope you and your family are well in these difficult times.
Oh, thank you for asking. Yeah, we're managing.
Good. Yes,
exactly. Pulling merrily along, like everyone else. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. So I'm going to make a short introduction in Spanish, and then we're going to move into English. If
sure.
That's all right with you. Good.
Yes.
This book, The Royalist Revolution, fue publicado por Harvard University Press en 2014. Su tesis central es que en la década de 1770, previo a la Declaración de Independencia, los futuros padres fundadores de Estados Unidos, George Washington, John Adams, Thomas Jefferson, Alexander Hamilton, entre muchos otros, defendieron una posición reformista, pero no necesariamente antimonárquica. Su objetivo habría sido retomar la antigua relación de dependencia entre el rey inglés y las colonias ultramarinas, perdidas a manos de los revolucionarios del siglo XVII, una de cuyas consecuencias fue la subordinación del monarca al poder del parlamento. Los colonos norteamericanos, en otras palabras, habrían buscado reformar el régimen monárquico, aceptando e incluso aplaudiendo la intervención del rey en los asuntos americanos, pero de ninguna manera sometiéndose a las prerrogativas del parlamento. Fue solo una vez que el rey se negó a aceptar la oferta de los colonos, que el movimiento reformista de la década de 1770 devino abiertamente revolucionario y separatista. Esa es la tesis central del libro, y la siguiente conversación tiene por objetivo desentrañar dicho tránsito. So, Professor Nelson, let me start with three very general historiographical questions.
Sure.
First, how did you become interested in this subject? Second, what was the role of intellectual history while developing your arguments and hypotheses? And third, in what sense your approach differs from what you call in the introduction the reductionist economic interpretation of the revolution?
Okay, well, so the first one, the first question, I have to say the answer is a little boring in that I'd always been very interested as a sort of hobby in the history of colonial America and the revolution. And I had written about it in a very cursory way, just in one chapter of the first book that I wrote, which was based on my PhD dissertation, which was called The Greek Tradition and Republican Thought, where I was really following the impact of the revival of Greek and the study of the Greek language in the sort of 14th, 15th centuries on the direction that political thought takes in Europe, particularly in the Republican tradition, or what we come to call the Republican tradition, in the 16th and 17th centuries. And I sort of have a coda about America, but it was never something that I imagined myself working on in any serious way. The origin of this was that I guess back in 2009, it's a long time ago now, a group of undergraduates at Harvard came to my office hours to complain that there was no course being offered at Harvard on the American Revolution.
Yeah.
And I have to say my first reaction was, you know, go look harder. I mean, you know, we have like seven early Americanists just in the history department. Surely there is a course being offered on the revolution. But it turned out that they were right. You could study, the Haitian Revolution. You could study sort of quilt making in the 18th century or whatever. But there was no course being offered on the revolution. And I thought that was just intolerable, particularly since, as you may know, Harvard itself was sort of ground zero for the revolutionary movement in Massachusetts.
Absolutely, yeah, for sure.
Ways. I thought, well, look, I can't pass myself off as some kind of 18th century social and economic historian, but I could get my act together and teach a course on the political thought of the revolution.
Yeah.
And really, when I set out to do that, and I expected to be teaching some version of the standard story about the revolution that I had learned from my great teachers.
Yes.
But by way of preparing for the course, I just sort of sat down over that summer and read through a great deal of the pamphlet literature of the revolutionary decade, sort of 1763, roughly, the end of the of what we call the French and Indian War, what the rest of the solar system calls the Seven Years' War.
The Seven Years' War, yeah.
Yes, the First World War. The end of that until really through the ratification of the Constitution. And as I was doing that, I kept running into what to me was very unexpected material. In particular, given the fact that I'd always been taught that these revolutionary figures, the people we call founding fathers or patriots, were sort of radical Whigs and indeed Republicans in some radical sense, I was finding very strange things, like they were praising and agreeing with Charles I in constitutional debates of the 17th century, and that's not what Whigs are supposed to do. So I just became particularly curious about that relatively narrow issue, which was just why, you know, what is the role of the Stuart monarchy, and particularly the monarchy of Charles I, and the historical memory of the English Revolution of the 1640s and 50s, what role is that playing in revolutionary debate, and why are they being led to, as it were, defending the king's royalist cause rather than the parliamentarian and then sort of Whig cause? And I just thought, possibly I would write an article about that.
Yes.
As often happens in these things, one thing leads to another, and I realized as I was chipping away at it that there was actually much more that I felt I could say. So it was really quite serendipitous, and it really emerged from the experience of preparing for and then teaching this course. So that's what I'd say about the first. The second question. I am about the relationship between the project and intellectual history. I was trained as an intellectual historian, at both Cambridge East and Cambridge West.
Yes.
And so that's my orientation, to be very interested in the history of arguments in political theory, and I have a great sort of passionate curiosity for the way that they're structured, and the way that that positions emerge and then become dominant over time. And this seemed to be a really interesting illustration of exactly that point: arguments popping up for the first time, such that you could really show that these were arguments that even a couple of years earlier would have seemed outrageous in the very same audience in which they were emerging, but which become a sort of a matter of dogma and consensus very quickly. And so that's very much what I was trying to study. And that leads me to the third question, which is, how does this differ from the sort of what you call reductive, or yes, the sort of we in this country associate that tradition of a particularly revolutionary historiography with the great historian Charles Beard, who wrote really in the Progressive Era and early in the 20th century. And in essence, as the name of the position suggests, the view is that really all this stuff about ideas and rights and the imperial constitution and all the rest of it is just sort of, as the great Louis Namier put it, flapdoodle. It's just sort of window dressing. It's what you sort of say because you have to say something, but what's really doing the work is that economic interests underwent an extraordinary transformation, and it became extremely attractive and urgent as the Atlantic economy developed in the later 18th century for American, for sort of British American merchants in particular to break free of the sort of British Navigation Acts and mercantilist system, and that really that's what's going on, and I'm deeply unpersuaded of this.
Yes,
I think that's a very poor explanation, and I really come much more from the tradition that was inaugurated by my mentor and friend Bernard Bailyn in the 1960s. Which seeks to return us to the mental world of the people who made the revolution and asks us to take what they thought they were doing seriously as a causal explanation of what they did. And that's really what I try to do.
Right. Fantastic. Let me ask you a more, say, methodological question.
Yes.
Your book deals with various geographical and chronological scenarios. We have Great Britain, we have the 13 colonies, we also have monarchical government in England and also in the colonies, but we also have Parliament in London, the different local governments throughout North America. So we have all sort of, you know, scenarios. Do you think it would be accurate to say that you wrote history of the origins of the United States from an imperial perspective rather than falling into a more national explanation of the revolution of 1776? In other words, what was the role of the empire, of the structures of the empire during, before, during, and after the 1776 revolution?
Yeah, it's a fabulous question. And the answer is basically yes. I think that's a good characterization of what I'm trying to do. I mean, I'd narrow it a little bit just insofar as of course, if you're interested in the imperial dimension of the revolution, again, you're interested in many, many things. You're interested in the structure of the Atlantic economy. You're interested in the slave trade and its history, and you know all kinds of other things. My focus is political theory, and one of the things that I absolutely take seriously, and in a way, this goes back to the very early brilliant study of the origins of the revolution by one of my heroes, Charles Howard McIlwain, whose book *The American Revolution: A Constitutional Interpretation* came out in 1923. I mean, a very long time ago. But it was really McIlwain who pointed to the way in which the question of the imperial constitution and its structure was the basic issue in controversy in this period, and that of course that meant that the terms of debate and the sources that provide the subject for this debate are imperial sources. That's to say, sources, first of all, of English history and eventually British history.
Right.
Once we get to the Act of Union, but also the actual history of argument about empire. In Britain itself and in the colonies and in the various different legislatures that you're talking about, and trying to reason about the significance of actual imperial practices, the relationship between the colonies, for instance, just to take an example that preoccupied them extraordinarily, was the question of judicial appeals, because there was this peculiar fact, which is to say that in Britain itself, as you may know, in the 18th century, judicial appeals, the highest sort of court of appeal was in the House of Lords. It was technically the House of Lords that would hear the appeal. Now, that was the Law Lords, the highest court. But this was not true for the colonies. The colonies, there are differences amongst them, but in general, the standard constitutional structure was that judicial appeals would be heard by the king in council. Yeah. That's to say by the Privy Council in London, but not by the House of Lords. And so what's the significance of that? What's the significance of the fact that the House of Lords seems to have no role in this crucial aspect of governance in America, but that the king does have this role, which departs from the British model itself as it evolved in the metropolitan sort of homeland in the 18th century, and they draw really powerful lessons from this, or implications about the structure of the imperial constitution. So yeah, I think they're thinking necessarily about these imperial structures, what they mean, and how they can be fit into the categories of English, of received English political and sort of constitutional thought. Yeah, I do think that.
Which lead us to the 17th century and to the question on what was the view or the reaction of the American subjects, the colonies of the 17th century's revolutions, both revolutions. In what sense did the colonial subjects think the king should retake the position he had enjoyed prior to the 1740s? And and why were they so critical of the English Parliament's right to interfere in colonial affairs, which is basically the main question you ask in your book, right?
Yeah, that is the main question. Yeah. And it's basically to say that this is the major transformation. That, as good Whigs, and of course, most of these figures that we're talking about were brought up as good Atlantic Whigs. In their historical imagination, the parliamentarians were the heroes of the 17th century struggle. And of course, the Stuarts, the hated Stuarts, who were regarded as tyrannical, crypto-Catholic, and all the rest, were the villains in the story. And it's that sort of consensus that begins to come under enormous strain in the 1760s, as Parliament, for the first time, in the wake of the Seven Years' War, passes bills levying direct taxes of various kinds on the colonies. And initially, the response to this shift away from the status quo goes through stages in the 1760s, and I'll just sort of abbreviate by saying, initially, most try to argue that, yes, of course, we're subjects of something called the British Empire, and Parliament is the supreme legislature of the British Empire, and therefore Parliament, of course, has legitimate jurisdiction over America, but it just isn't allowed to tax us. And it would come up with some narrower, some broader arguments about why that was the case. Ultimately, they realize these arguments don't work, and that basically, particularly because of the position that they develop on the relationship between the famous one, the slogan, no taxation without representation. Yeah. Yeah. So they argue that they're not represented by the Westminster Parliament, and therefore taxing a tax regime imposed on them from Westminster would amount to alien rule, that's to say slavery, dependence on an alien power. The problem is that sort of proves too much, because if Parliament really is an alien power, then it seems that anything that it does to legislate over America, and not just taxation, would be enslaving. And so ultimately, after lots of fits and starts in debate with their opponents, they arrive at the position that that Parliament actually has no jurisdiction over America, and that... so then the question is, well, okay, Parliament has no jurisdiction over America, then in what respect are we British subjects? Yeah. And the answer that they emerge with is we're connected solely through the person of the king. The king is king of America, he's king of Massachusetts, he's king of Virginia, he's king of New York, just as he's king of Great Britain. But the legislature of Great Britain has no more authority over the people of New York than the legislature of New York has over the people of Great Britain. So it's this kind of spokes on a wheel model. And that's the model they begin to theorize. Well, they then realize, in part because of documents from the 17th century that had just recently been published, including records of the debates in the House of Commons, that that position actually had been the Stuart position in the 17th century, that it was the James and Charles I who had made their argument, that is arguing that the foreign plantations, as they were called, the American colonies, were solely dominions of the crown to be governed by the royal prerogative, and that Parliament had no jurisdiction at all over the colonies. Mm. And there was a famous incident that becomes just the most the sort of locus classicus for this is that there's a debate in the 1621 Parliament where the House of Commons is debating a bill that was proposed to regulate the tobacco trade in Virginia and another one to regulate fishing in the Atlantic, which was an enormous source of revenue. So vastly significant legislation. And the King's Secretary of State, who happens to be George Calvert, later Lord Baltimore and a famous Catholic, the founder of the Maryland colony, comes into the House of Commons on behalf of the King and shuts the debate down and says, you have no business debating this. This is a matter for the King and for the royal prerogative. And it's the great Whig heroes, the parliamentarians, who argue absolutely not. Parliament has jurisdiction over America. And then ultimately, these are the figures who, when they cut off the king's head in 1649, assert for the first time complete parliamentary control over America and pass the first bill successfully legislating for America in 1650-51, which is the first of the Navigation Act. So basically, as the story begins to consolidate and develop in British America in the late 1760s and early 1770s, is that the valiant Stuarts were actually defending the liberties of America and the independent status of these colonies under the crown. And it was these rapacious parliamentarians who murder their king, who then seize what were his legitimate prerogatives, and then illegally, unconstitutionally, begin to legislate for America, setting the precedent for what then happens in the 1760s. So they begin to see this as the moment of original sin, the moment where everything went wrong. And the people who had it right were James and Charles I, and the people who had it wrong were their parliamentary opponents. So that changes things very dramatically. Yeah.
Absolutely, yeah. Estamos con Eric Nelson, quien escribió este magnífico libro, The Royalist Revolution, Monarchy and the American Foundation. So I would like to keep talking about this 17th century, 18th century thing. I see in your work an implicit difference between the concept of monarchy, which you use quite often in your book, and the concept of empire. Mm-hmm. It seems that people like John Adams, especially, were not willing to depart from the monarchy in the 1760s and 1770s, although they were ready to depart from some of the institutions of the empire, Parliament above all, for all what you have explained. Mm. We find something similar in Spanish America, a couple of decades later, where the first revolutionaries sought to create a constitutional monarchy with the Spanish king at the head of it, but without accepting the intervention of the Spanish courts, which it's more or less the same role they played as Parliament. Yeah. So my question is, did Adams and other revolutionaries in North America actually believe it was possible to create a constitutional monarchy in the colonies, having King George III as their monarch, as their direct monarch, without going through the intervention of Parliament?
It's a fantastic question because it points to the radicalism of their position. And one of the things we haven't talked about yet is the degree to which, of course, the English Constitution had undergone an enormous transformation in the century between the English Revolution and the American Revolution. That's to say, the English themselves had fought two revolutions, one in the 1640s and one in 1688-89, the so-called Glorious Revolution, to subject the king to Parliament. And the balance of power had shifted definitively. And the idea of the supreme legislature as the king in Parliament, as Parliament fundamentally doing the acting through a ministry that was appointed by the king, but which had to maintain the support of the House of Commons in particular, and whose members always sat in one of the two houses, either the House of Lords or the House of Commons, and the erosion of the prerogatives of the crown that had been at issue in the 17th century, chiefly the negative or the veto, right? That's to say, as a matter of law, of course, even as you and I are talking right now, Queen Elizabeth II has the negative voice. That is, you know, technically, a bill does not become law until it receives the royal assent. And she can refuse her assent but everyone realizes that that's a matter of law, that it is not, an actual matter, a prerogative of hers. It's no longer something she really has the power or ability to do. And that system had already begun to develop in the period we're talking about. So the last veto of a parliamentary bill by an English monarch came in 1707-8. And even that was a very unusual case. And so most people on both sides of the Atlantic believed wrongly that no monarch had vetoed a bill since before the Glorious Revolution. So they saw the veto as a bygone, long defunct power of the crown. And yet the colonists were asking George III to revive it. They were asking him to use the veto to strike down these bills that Parliament had passed to which they objected. And even more broadly, just as you say, this model of kind of spokes on the wheel, right, where you have the king at the center and then a set of independent states who simply share his monarchy, but which are not part of a confederal imperial structure, that would require, they all realized, making the king into a sort of emperor. At the center of all this, wielding the veto to make sure that all of the different constituent legislatures were pursuing a coherent imperial policy. And so that was what was so shocking in Britain itself. So, you know, it's very important to remember and recognize that in Britain itself, the American Patriot movement was not regarded as Republican and Whig. It was regarded as absolutist and Jacobite, right? These were people who were trying to undo the results of the Glorious Revolution and re-empower the crown. So the model that you're talking about is exactly the one that becomes salient in Latin America in the subsequent decades. It's this model that denies, in the American case, denies that there was ever actually, as a legal or constitutional matter, such a thing as the British Empire. Their argument was that this thing called the British Empire is a fiction. All there is the British monarch who happens to be king of a set of distinct dominions, and they're only connected through him. And their model for understanding this was, and it's, by the way, not at all a coincidence, the number, a disproportionate number of the major theorists who were sort of setting out this case had deep connections with Scotland, because Their model was exactly Scotland between what was called the Union of the Crowns in 1603. When, so remember, Queen Elizabeth I dies, she doesn't have any heir, I mean, no natural children. And so the crown passes to her cousin, James the Sixth of Scotland, who becomes James the First of England. So he's king of two different countries, Scotland and England. But there, those two countries were in no way merged. They remained independent realms. They were governed, they had their own religious establishments, their own courts, their own legal systems, and all the rest, their own peers. And and not until the Act of Union were they actually, a century later, were they actually consolidated into a single realm. And the argument is that's exactly the imperial structure. You know, New York is to Great Britain what Scotland was to England in that period. Mm-hmm. Now, your question, which is the crucial one, is, were they serious about this? Did they think that there was any chance that this incredibly radical repositioning of the crown would be accepted in Britain itself? And the answer is, they seem to have thought that although it would obviously have required a major shift in existing imperial practice, it would be preferable to the British public, to the extent that the public was involved, but the ministry and parliament, to an actual loss of the colonies. So they fully realized that this was a radical proposal from the point of view of the ministry, but on the one hand, they felt it had historical precedent. That is, they thought it was actually the correct understanding of the British Constitution in its imperial dimension. So they thought they had law and precedent and the Constitution on their side, they also clearly felt that the king, in whom they put all of their hopes, would regard this as in his interests, right? That is to say, he would recognize, as indeed he did, this they were right about, that what they were proposing was a significant enhancement of the royal prerogative and a massive strengthening of the crown abroad and then by implication at home. What they didn't reckon on was that George III was terrified by this. That's to say, he had sort of seen this movie before and he knew how it ended. His view was, yeah, I walk out and say I'm making myself king emperor, reviving the veto, you know, appointing my own ministers at pleasure and so on. You know, they'll have me on a scaffold, the next week. So, and that was also a crucial part of the public dimension of debate and discussion of American affairs in the 1770s, so that when George III finally officially rejects the American position in his famous speech in October of 1775, where he declares the colonies in rebellion and dismisses their constitutional theory, in essence, and claims that he has no interest in any of this, and indeed argues that they don't really even mean it. When he does this, this is greeted in Britain with euphoria, and all of these, basically every major corporation, town, guild, institution in the country writes a celebratory address congratulating the king for refusing to take the bait. Basically saying, here are these, you know, American absolutist Jacobites who were trying to get our good Whig Protestant king to become a Stuart, but he was too virtuous to succumb to temptation. And thank God we had such a prince on the throne. So that's, you know, that's how it was seen in Britain. Yeah,
fantastic. Now, leaving aside a little bit colonial history and also history of revolution and moving into US, you know, history after independence.
Yes.
As a consequence of the revolution and the Declaration of Independence, a new Republican consensus was reached among the revolutionaries. They left the monarchy and they became, you know, both revolutionaries, independent, and also Republicans. So the monarchy was no longer seen as a viable political project, and Republican institutions were the only ones qualified, or so they patriots thought, of building a stable political system. The problem, and this is this also happened in other parts of the world, Spanish America among them, the problem was that there was not a clear consensus on how that republic should be shaped and built. So my question is, what were the main political debates at stake during the 1780s that ended up creating the US Republic as we know, as we currently know it?
Yeah, it's a fantastic question, and I could go on about it for for a very long time. But the first thing is to say that that I think the premise is correct. That's to say, particularly after the king's speech that I just mentioned, and this trauma, this sense of betrayal that British Americans felt after the king turned on them, since they'd put all of their hope in him for so long. And along with the publication of this very famous pamphlet, Thomas Paine's Common Sense, which came out in January of 76, which happened also to be the month that the text of the King's speech finally reached British America. Paine was a genuine radical, a genuine radical Whig. And he introduced this fierce attack on kingship for the first time into the debate. The key thing to recognize is that most of the people who actually made the revolution, that is to say, the people who were the leading figures in the imperial crisis and the opposition movement and the Continental Congress in the 1770s, largely were appalled by this. That's to say, they were appalled by two things. They were appalled, first of all, by Paine's sort of ferocious attack on kingship, which was, after all, an institution that they'd been arguing should be strengthened rather than eliminated or weakened, but also his unicameralism, that is, his belief that there should the legislature should be in only one house, one legislative chamber. And that system was adopted famously in 1776 in Pennsylvania, which was the colony where Paine had set up shop, where he lived. And so the question, really points to the way in which the various states, so there are two dimensions to your question, which is what makes it so interesting and difficult. That is, on the one hand, we're talking about constitutional debates within the different colonies, now states, about the proper form of the state constitution. And that debate goes, as I try to show, through stages. So in 1776 itself, so about eight states adopt constitutions in that first year. And those really do bear the mark of that fervent anti-monarchical Thomas Paine common sense moment. And the major people who I focus on, John Adams, James Wilson, Alexander Hamilton, all the rest, opposed these new constitutions. They hated them for exactly the reasons that they felt that the structure of these constitutions departed from what had emerged as their preferred form of political science, which was this very powerful monarchical figure connected directly to the people and protecting their liberties from tyrannical legislatures, because their idea was that was really what the revolution was about. The revolution was about a tyrannical legislature, parliament, attempting to enslave the people, and what the people needed was a king to defend their liberties. And so Even if you weren't going to be able to call this person king anymore, they felt that you needed such a figure. You needed a governor who would have all of the same prerogatives that they were attempting to persuade George III to revive unsuccessfully. So they're very disappointed in that first period. But as the tide begins to turn in 1777 and deep problems with these first constitutions begin to show themselves, there is a turn toward increasingly powerful executives. It becomes more palatable, first in New York in 1777, which is the first state constitution other than South Carolina's, which is a special story, that actually gives the governor a veto, although it's hemmed in lots of complicated ways. He can't wield it by himself. But he is popularly elected, which makes him independent of the legislature. And so that they like. And by the time you get the Constitution of Massachusetts, which of course we still have in operation, the oldest continuously functioning written constitution in the world, the constitution of the state I'm sitting in right now, the 1780 constitution largely written by John Adams creates a very powerful governor. And Adams had proposed an absolute veto with no override capacity, for the legislature. He loses that one, so the legislature can override a veto, but it's extremely difficult. It requires a supermajority, and that really becomes the model in important ways for what happens in Philadelphia in 1787 at the national level. So that's the other level, right? So yes. So. First of all, you have what's going on in the individual states, but then you have what's going on in the early republic under what were called the Articles of Confederation. That is to say, the first structure that was agreed to by the states for a common national government. One of the things that's important to remember at that national level is that the Articles of Confederation were finally, they were proposed very early, but they didn't actually come into effect until very late. They're not really in effect until 1780, 81. You know, it takes a long time because there are holdout states that refuse to ratify. So in all of this time, the federal government consists entirely of Congress, the Continental Congress. Which becomes this new thing called the Congress, but which has no executive initially. And there is also no federal judiciary initially. There is also no sort of federal administrative state. There is this Congress, which is made up of a very small number of representatives of the different states, and they have to agree in order to do various things, but their powers are very limited, and in particular, they can't tax, and they can't raise revenue in lots of other ways. So you have these two dimensions, and the sort of lack of a strong executive is being felt at both levels, right? Yeah. At the state level and at the national level. And that is what allows these same figures. I mean, one of the major points I try to make in the book is that the people I'm talking about, for the most part, never change their minds. They're kind of, they're speaking for public opinion in the early 1770s. Then public opinion turns against them in 1776. And then it comes back their way by the time you get to the later 1780s, where they end up in the convention being able to get most of what they want, which is to say a president who is much more powerful than any British monarch had been since just after the Glorious Revolution. So that's the arc of the story I try to tell about the way that constitutional structures develop.
Yeah. We are running out a little bit of time, so I have one final question which builds on what you were saying. I think one of the most original aspects of your book is the importance you give to continuities between the old regime and the new presidential system granted in the 1787 Constitution.
Yeah.
In line with what Tocqueville's, you know, argued for the French case in his The Old Regime and the Revolution, we find, thanks to your book, that the US Republic has many similarities with the monarchy, not least in the power the Constitution gives to the president, who in many ways resembles the figure of the king, or at least the power given to the king, it's inherited by the new president. Do you think it is possible to conclude that the US presidential system, the one we know exists now, yes, is the last act of the royalist revolution starting in the 1770s?
I do think that. I mean, I think I would only offer one friendly amendment to what you say, and that is, I don't actually, one of the points that I try to make is it's not quite right to say that what the colonists were doing was simply trying to maintain the British monarchy and imperial structure. No. And sort of as they existed in the 18th century, in the late 18th century, and then sort of transport them into this new framework. It was a very radical position. They were not, if you like, conservatives, because the people who were conservatives were their opponents, who were saying, look, we have a Whig monarchy, we have a ministry, we have, you know, we have a supreme parliamentary legislature. This is, you know, this is what we've had for generations. Yeah, they were revolutionaries, but they were revolutionaries who wanted to go back, right? Yes, they wanted to go back. Reform. So the monarchy that they wanted wasn't the British monarchy of the 1760s and 70s. It was a sort of reimagined version of the British monarchy that had existed before the Whig revolutions. And so actually, the constitutional structure that I think the American Constitution most resembles is in fact the Stuart monarchy of the earlier 17th century, rather than the parliamentary ministerial yes. monarchy yes. Of the post-Glorious Revolution period. And I think that if you see it that way, and if you look at our politics that way, you can see that that comparison is helpful. That's to say that we really, we enjoy the benefits of, but we also suffer from the dangers of that constitutional form. Yeah. In particular, the fact that the British monarchy before the Whig revolutions, before the supremacy of the House of Commons, it really required consensus among these independent branches of the constitutional structure, each of which had a veto over the others. That's to say you had king, lords, and commons, and each had to agree in order for anything important to occur, and each had prerogatives and privileges that could be wielded by no one else, right? So only the House of Commons could raise revenue. Only the House of Lords could judge. Only the king could sort of execute in you know as head of what was called the government at the time, which is just what we now call the executive. Only the king could pardon, for instance, and yeah. so on. So the question, you know, so when these branches can find a way of working together, right? Of course, what you get out of this is that tyranny is very difficult. Right, you make tyranny and oppression quite difficult because you have lots of checks and balances. But what is very much in the cards is impasse. Right, if one of these branches goes on strike and refuses to perform its constitutional function, you know, if the House of Commons or the House of Representatives now simply refuses to fund the government, right? There is no recourse in the Constitution. No one can do that except the House of Representatives, right? No one can confirm nominees to the courts, let's say, except our Senate. And no one but the President can enforce the law or can do lots of other things like pardon. And of course, they each have a veto over legislation. That's to say, a bill in order to become law has to be passed by both houses of Congress and in most cases signed by the president unless a supermajority would override the veto, which is very rare. So so the danger really is what happens when the norms of cooperation amongst these branches erode or collapse. What happens when they exert the maximum of their prerogatives and walk right up to the line and go on strike? Then you have paralysis and very deep crisis, which is what happened in England in the 1640s. And to some degree, what's been happening in our politics in the United States for the last decade. So, so I think that once you see it this way, once you see that actually the best comparand for the United States in its constitutional dimension is not, Florence or Venice or Athens or even Britain in its modern parliamentary form, but rather this earlier version of the English Constitution, then I think a lot becomes clear that can seem obscure.
Fantastic. This has been a wonderful conversation. I wish we would have more time to keep talking. Just a small reference. I have seen that you have published a new book called The Theology of Liberalism. Regretfully, we don't have enough time to discuss, but who knows, perhaps we could have another podcast in the near future.
Yeah,
that would be, for us, would be absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, I love it. Very different.
Very different. Yeah, yes. I've seen the blurs and the introduction.
Yeah. Yeah.
So definitely. Well, anyway, thank you very, very much, Professor Nelson, for this very interesting and stimulating conversation. Hemos estado hablando de este fantástico libro del profesor Eric Nelson de Harvard, The Royalist Revolution. Esperamos que les haya gustado la conversación y los dejamos invitados para una nueva un nuevo programa de podcast organizado por el Centro de Estudios Públicos. Un abrazo y muchas gracias. Thank you very much, Eric.
Thank you so much.